Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we humbly request you to lead us in the study of your word. And may you speak to our hearts and transform us unto the likeness of Jesus in the power of the Holy Spirit. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. I was told that one time a church prayed and fasted for rain because there was a severe drought in the area. They came together and they said, "We serve a living and powerful God, and our God is so mighty that we need to see his power. We need to see him at work in our community. We need the people to know that our God is mighty." So they came together, they fasted, and they prayed. And they gave God an appointment. They said, "Lord, we are going to meet you at so-so and so place, at so-so and so time, this date. And at that time, on that day, we will expect you to pour out rain, and we will glorify your name." So that day, the church gathered, and as they were standing, waiting for the rain, a little girl brought an umbrella. And the pastor said, "My daughter, why did you bring an umbrella?" And the girl said, "I thought it's going to rain." She was the only person who believed. Many times we ask for things we don't really believe in. Many times we ask for things we are not ready to handle. So my question is, are you ready to handle the rain? It is easy to come, spend some time. This is not the first camp. This will not be the last. But has it rained? Will it rain? And you have been bold enough to say it will rain. Let me take off with this. Teachers may understand this better. Teachers are supposed to have high expectations of their students. And God has very high expectations of us. In Mark 12:30, he says, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart," puso, kasing, "with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength." In other words, Jesus is saying that God expects total consecration from us, not half-baked consecration. Elsewhere in 1 Thessalonians 5:23, it says, "May the God of peace himself sanctify you." How? Entirely. "And may your spirit and soul and body be preserved complete without blame." In other words, God expects total sanctification. These are very, very high expectations. And let me submit to you that this cannot happen to us if it doesn't reign in us. The message is entitled, The Greatest Blessing Ever. If I ask you, are you blessed? I'm sure most of you will say yes. And I don't know what you think about when you say I'm blessed. Some people think that, oh, I have life. I'm in school. I have my family with me. I have my siblings. I have friends. Some of us can say my parents are wealthy, so I am also wealthy. Some think of blessings in terms of material things. If I ask you, are you blessed? You may think of all kinds of things and conclude, yes, I am blessed. But let me ask you, when you see a poor in spirit, do you think that he's blessed? Because Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit. So let me ask you, are you blessed? When you see the persecuted because of the kingdom, do you think that they are blessed or cursed? Because Jesus says that they are blessed. You know, when you read the word of God, it is totally different from everything that we have in our minds. It doesn't match. The greatest blessing ever. And that's a topic. Blessing is a very huge topic. There are levels of blessing. There is what I call the general blessing. That is a blessing that every human being gets. And Jesus says in Matthew 5 that God makes the sun to shine on the righteous and the wicked. He makes the rain to fall on the righteous and the wicked. Everybody gets the sun. Everybody gets the air. That's general blessing. There is another level of blessing. That is a kind of blessing you receive from your father. In the Bible, people have been blessed by their fathers. And some of us have never been blessed by our father. So we are operating under the general blessing. There is another level of blessing. That's the blessing of the pastor. When a man of God lays his hand on you at God's command, that's another level of blessing. And another is when God himself anoints you. So my question is, under which blessing are you operating here at AUP? How many are you operating under? Because you know what? No need to paint you a picture. It is obvious that the world that Satan is preparing for you is an anti-church, anti-scripture, and anti-God world. Just watch the news. A time is coming, and it is now, when it will be very difficult even to preach the good news. It will be very challenging even to stand for the right. Am I making sense? And when you look at us Christians slumbering and sometimes supporting the world, you ask yourself, are we ready for the battle? You know, a time is coming, and it is now, when just the mention of the name of God will put you into trouble. The mere mention of prayer will put you into trouble. You just look at how the world is mocking Christianity today. How they feel that God should not be part of our schools, that God should not be part of our parliaments, that God should not be part of our governments, that God should not be part of the world. And can you tell me that you are going to enter such a world unprepared? Living under the general blessing like everyone else? Do you think you will survive? And then when you look at the news, you look at what is going on, you find yourself lost, confused, unsure. Some people are not sure whether the Bible is still the Word of God, even in the church. You are not clear anymore about right and wrong. You are perplexed and you ask yourself, will I make it? You are perplexed and ask yourself, how will I survive in such a world? You are disoriented. You are bewildered. And I can see people today trembling of fear at any news. The Pope said, the GC is coming. Let's pray, let's kneel down. Let's find time because we need the rain. So my question, the question I'm answering is this. What to do in a world irremediably turning anti-God? You will see amazing things happening. You will see pastors. What did I say? I want to qualify the pastors. You will see Adventist pastors leaving the faith in numbers. You will see priests. What did I say? Coming into the faith by numbers. You will see prostitutes, what did I say? Coming into the faith by numbers. And you will see deacons and deaconesses and elders leaving the faith by numbers. Things are happening, folks. Laws are being enforced. Plans are being laid to make your life miserable and impossible. To make you feel that it is not fun, it is not good, it is not right to be a Christian. It is not fun, it is not good to believe in God. Stuff like that is coming. Let me be plain. So what to do? It reminded me of a man in the Bible. His name was Jacob. You know his story, right? He was the son of Isaac. His mother's name was Absalom. Whoa! What is that? Please, Lord, let it rain. Absalom. Rebecca. He had a twin brother, Esau. Since the womb, they were fighting. And as they grew up, Jacob became very cunning. He was mama's boy, always in the kitchen. And Esau was papa's boy, always out hunting and bringing good meat home. And papa loved Esau. Mama loved Jacob. And Mama taught Jacob a few tricks how to deal with Papa and get the blessing and the inheritance. And then Jacob had to run away because Esau was very angry. And he spent 20 years, how many years? 20 years working for his uncle, Laban. Now, those 20 years, he worked 7 years first for his wife. He said he loved Rahel, huh? 7 years. How many of you can work 7 years for a woman? He really loved her. And then they gave him Leah. And the guy was really, he said, okay, I'll work 7 more years. I still need Rahel. And he got Rahel and he worked 6 more years. And then he came back. For 20 years, Jacob had been alone in a foreign place, in a strange family, suffering. But he had a problem. You know, actually, when he came back, he was very wealthy. But something was missing in him. He felt that he needed something. Oh, that's very interesting. Is it raining? Yeah. Jacob had with him guilt. What word did I use? He could realize that he had done wrong to God, to his father, to his mother, to his brother, to himself, and to the cause of God. And for 20 years, he was not feeling good. He had a lot of money, but he was not feeling good. So he went back at God's command. And at a point, the Bible says that he was left alone. And a man wrestled with him until the break of the day. And the man was wrestling, and Jacob was getting a little stronger than him. And the man said, hey, if I don't take care, this guy will bring me down here. So the man said, let me go. The day is breaking. And Jacob said, let us read that sentence together. I will not let you go unless you bless me. What is the title of the message? The greatest blessing ever. Now, I thought that being wealthy is being blessed. But Jacob is wealthy and he's asking for blessing. Did I say something? I thought that getting married was being blessed. But this guy has 4 wives. And he's asking for a blessing. I thought that having children was being blessed. He had how many? How many children? 13. He had a daughter. And yet, he's asking for a blessing. And he needs it so badly that he holds that strong man and tells him, if you don't bless him, you are not leaving. Somebody today must tell God, if you don't bless me, you are not leaving. If you don't bless me, I am not leaving. Somebody should say, God, I am tired of living such a miserable life with such a wonderful God as Father. Today must stop this miserable life. I need your blessing. You must bless me. You know, Hosea commented on this story. Hosea is a prophet, very interesting prophet. But in chapter 12 of his book, he made a commentary and he said, Jacob took his brother by the heel in the womb, comma, and in his strength, he struggled with God. Now, these two sentences are the summary of Jacob's life. When he was younger, he was a cheat. When he became older, he converted. Hello? Yes, says Hosea. Yes, he struggled with the angel and prevailed. Watch out. Some people think that the struggle was merely physical. It was a spiritual struggle. Because Hosea said that Jacob wept. He didn't cry. He wept. Do you know what it means to weep? And sought favor from him. He found him in Bethel, and there he spoke to us, that is the Lord God of hosts. Some of us, like Jacob, we have a past. Hello? Did you know that Jacob never saw his mother again? Did you know that because of what he did, the family broke up? Some of us, we've done things in our families and the family broke up because of what we did. The choices we made, the things we said, the stuff we brought in the home, the people we brought in our homes, in our lives, broke our home like Jacob broke his home. But the good news is that though he did it, he was able to find favor with God, because he told God in faith, if you don't bless me, I am not letting you go. It must rain on me. If it doesn't rain, I am not letting you go. You are not leaving me. Ellen White comments this passage. She brings another comment. Don't worry for me. She said, let's read it together. Through humiliation, repentance, and self-surrender. This sinful, erring mortal prevailed with the majesty of heaven. Did you know that you can fight with God and win? There is one weapon that God cannot resist. And that weapon is self-surrender. I hope you can still hear me. Can you hear me? It is raining. You see, when it rains, you get closer. Okay. Now, let's read what Ellen White has to say about Jacob's experience. She says, Jacob's experience during that night of wrestling and anguish represents the trial through which the people of God must pass just before the second coming It is a true story that is also symbolic. It is something that happened in reality, but that has prophetic meaning. Did you know that the Jacob struggle represented our struggle before Christ returns? And mind you, there was nobody there. No Satan, no demon, because he was fighting the greatest battle you can fight in your life, the battle against self. He could see, looking at his past, that he was lost and confused. He could see, looking at his past, that he had no hope. But he could remember that the God of his forefathers was merciful. Amen? That the God of his forefathers was good and loving. That he could go to him and hang on him and cling to him and tell him in the face, God, my Father, if you do not bless me, I will not let you go. He understood that it's not about money, not about diploma, not about family. When it comes to eternity, there is a point when we must make everything right with God alone. The Bible says that Jacob was alone. There are crises in our lives that we need to handle alone. Not even our spouse, not even our parents, not even our children, our colleagues must be there. There are times we need to be alone. And I want to talk to spouses. Allow your spouse to be alone with God. It is good for you also. So the time is coming, and it is now, when meeting like this to pray for the rain will be a challenge. It will be illegal. Enjoy the moment, because the time is coming when all these songs, you'll thank God for being at camp and learning Colossians 3, 1 and 2 through a song, because you won't have access to the Bible. You may not have access to the hymns. A time is coming. My question is, are you ready? If you want to be ready, you need the greatest blessing ever. You know, it's very difficult to speak today, because when you speak, you are intolerant. You are not loving anymore. You will see strange things. The other day, I watched a video. A mayor in Mexico married a crocodile. And the crocodile was wearing a wedding gown. And the amazing thing is that people were there, and there was a priest to bless the wedding. And they say it's because we want the people to be blessed. You are going to see the strangest things you've ever seen on earth happening day after day. At a time when the world is gradually but radically turning anti-church, anti-scripture, anti-God, God will have a people on earth who will be faithful witnesses of his love and power. God will have a people on earth. The question is, will you be part of that people? You know, This month, my morning devotion are about revival and reformation. For those who have my Facebook, you know I post every morning about it. Amazing things I discovered. Everybody wants revival. Everybody wants reformation, but nobody understands what it really, really, really entails. How many of us know? This is one aspect. In the time of Elijah, wow, this is not a rain, this is a flood. I hope you won't mind. I don't mind. Huh? In the time of Elijah, Elijah is also a symbol of revival and reformation. You remember he went on Mount Carmel and he did these wonderful things and fire came down from heaven. And then Ahab talked to his wife Jezebel and Jezebel told Elijah, I am going to deal with you. Elijah caught fear and he ran away. And then he said, Lord, I am left alone. There is only me in Israel. I have been speaking. Nobody is listening. I even made fire come down from heaven. It looks like I am the only one. Nobody is perfect. Nobody is holy. Nobody is a real Adventist. I am the only one. I am the only one speaking. And God told Elijah, hey, you keep quiet. There are 7,000 you don't know. God says, God kept myself 7,000. Not because you are not hearing them, but they are there hidden somewhere and they will come to light. Sometimes some of us, when we come back from camp, we look at what other people do. We start thinking, are we the only ones here who understand what is going on? And we exhibit the Elijah spirit. We start to think that we are the only one left on campus who pray. Why aren't my roommates praying? Please, check your life. Let them alone. God has his own people. Your business is to get your soul to heaven. So, don't think that because some people don't talk, they are not spiritual. Spirituality is not about being vocal or silent. Spirituality is being vocal or silent according to God's will. There are people on earth. You remember what I told you at the beginning? You will see pastors leaving the faith in numbers. And you will see prostitutes joining the faith in numbers. They are there. And Jesus has very interesting words. He said, be very careful lest the prostitutes and the publicans make it into the kingdom. And you, who've been attending camps, being deacon and deaconess, would be left out. Elijah almost lost his soul. Because he told God, I want to die. Come on, Elijah. But my question is, even if you are not Elijah, who was able to stand for God in a vocal manner, won't you be among the 7,000 who could stay faithful to God, though they did not speak aloud? And here, I am landing. Jesus said in Luke 11, 9 and 13. Very famous passage. Now, this passage is very interesting. And I want to invite you to take time and read the words of Jesus. Carefully. If you have a surface reading of the Bible, you will miss and you'll be misled. You will miss out in what Jesus wants to say. One of those passages, for example, the type is when Paul says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Huh? So in our minds, we think, I can do all things means I can buy all kinds of fancy cars through Christ. I can build all kinds of fancy mansions through Christ. That's what rings on our minds. But read Paul. Paul said before that, I know how to be rich and how to be poor. I know how to be full and how to be hungry. I can do all things through Christ. That is what Paul meant. Paul meant that no matter the circumstances, I will be faithful to God. And this is another passage. Jesus said, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find knock and it will be opened. And many times we take that passage and we put it in terms of asking for food and a life partner and a good grade, hello, and the possibility to graduate. These are all good things. But listen, Jesus said, if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit, give what? To those who ask. I want to submit to you today that the greatest blessing is the reception of the Holy Spirit. I want to say it again. The greatest blessing is the reception of the Holy Spirit in the heart. That is the greatest gift that God wants to give to us. Even when Jesus healed the people, he wanted to heal them because he needed them to receive the Spirit. Even when he took the 12, his focus was, let us meet Pentecost and let you receive the Holy Spirit. What Jesus wants us to have is the rain. So let it rain. That is what Jacob asked for. The Spirit of God in him. The blessing of God that he could receive in repentance and faith and confession and tell God, I need a force beyond me that can set me free from me. And some of us, we are living miserable Christian lives because the Holy Spirit is not there. We cannot stand 1 week of prayer. We get weak and weaker. When camp lasts 3 days, we get tired and we want to go back to the dorm. When the sermon is too long, we get mad at the pastor. We like the choir, we don't like the sermon. Have you noticed that? And we call ourselves Christians. And the battle is raging. The enemy is working hard behind the scenes. And we are here slumbering and complaining about the very things we need to be strong and stand firm during the battle. When it's time for midweek, we don't want to go to midweek. I am telling you, there is no point of coming here at this camp and attending all the sessions if next midweek you are not in church praying. I didn't say not in church simply. Not in church praying. Some people go to church, they don't pray. Some go to church, they don't even listen to the word of God. And when they come out, what did the preacher say? He said that Jesus loves us. Wow. There is no point of me coming here and attending all these sessions if tomorrow morning I cannot take my Bible alone and spend time with my Lord alone every day. And Jesus said, this is where I am ending, that God wants to give us much more. And one of my favorite Bible verses is
Ephesians 3:20. God is able. I'm getting excited. God is able to do. I'm getting more and more excited. God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we ask or even think of. The result of Jacob's experience was reconciliation with his brother Esau. And he could see that the guilt was done with. He had peace with God, peace with his brother. And he could move on with the work of God and his children. And I want to believe that somebody here today would love to have such an experience. Not only for you. When I'm speaking, I'm thinking about your family that you left home. Some of your parents don't even know God. Some of your siblings don't know God. Some of you, you have problems, issues with your family members. This is your opportunity to tell God, Father, I have done wrong in my own home. I want to make things right with you and with them. And I will not let you until you bless me. So, Father, let it rain. But that rain is only for those who like that little girl who brought the umbrella, act in faith. They may not see it, they will believe it. And God will fulfill it. So may God grant us grace to receive the greatest blessing ever, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. May God bless his word.